it is time for Knives Out. Yeah, this was planned in November, but I didn't feel like streaming, so sorry. Actually, it actually worked out in November because he literally starts with, oh, he died a week ago on November 8th. Oh, also, I am getting over COVID, so yeah. I got water here. Clear my throat. Keep myself hydrated. Should be good, but let's get into Knives Out. Ooh, that is bright. Oh, slow down. Science has been waiting. All right. Now, this is a mystery. And there's a lot in here to unpack. And my new format for reScribd, I'm going to try to limit that. I don't want to do more than 7 scenes. I'm going to do beginning and ending, 1 or 2 scenes that I feel are important to this, or good examples of screenwriting. Obviously, one of them is the reveal. So let's get into Knives Out. Let's see how it starts. I just rewatched it. Let's see how the script differs from the film. Written by Rian Johnson. Ensemble cast. Holy shit, this cast was amazing. Ana de Armas, Chris Evans. Damn. Why am I blanking on his name? James Bond. Why am I blanking on his name? Damn it. Why am I blanking on his name? Oh, man, that really sucks. Benoit Blanc. Daniel Craig. Yeah. Why did I blank on his name? Holy shit. Michael Shannon, Jamie Lee Curtis, Toni Collette. Catherine Langford, who I have not seen since. some other good actors in this as well. But yes, let's get into this. Oh yeah, Lakeith Stanfield's in this as well. I love him. He's great. He also has a movie coming up, Book of Clarence. Hopefully that's good. But let's get into the film. Been dilly-dallying a little too much. Here is Knives Out, a murder mystery by Rian Johnson. We start out the grounds of New England Manor, pre-dawn misty. All right, that's the end of the first scene. I'm kidding. Unlit and still, gothic, with a theme of antique games, arcane puzzles, and decorative weapons. First floor, a drawing room, living room, kitchen. A Detris of a party. Grey champagne flutes. Follow one housekeeper named Fran carrying a tray of coffee up a flight of stairs. Second floor. A hallway. Doors all closed. The house has not woken up. Fran steps lightly. Up a much narrower, creaky flight of steep stairs. Third floor. The master bedroom suite. Or to Mr. Thrombey. But the bed is empty, unslept in. A robe thrown across it. Fran heads out into the landing and up an even narrower half flight of stairs, which leads to a single door. Mr. Thrombey, you up there? Mr. Thrombey, I'm coming in. In his study, a cramped attic study, every shelf crammed with curios. Door swings open to Fran sees Harley Thrombey himself. 85 years old, slung across a white leather daybed. Throat slit, drenched in blood. Very much dead. tray slips out of her hands for a second. Shit!
And title card on black.
Knives out. Skip. Blanc, Elliot, Wagner stroll along the wide lawn beside the house. Blanc ignites a long, thin cigar. Maybe I'm a victim. Oh, wait. No, shit. That's not Blanc. All right, sorry. Maybe I'm a victim of my own expectations. When the great Benoit Blanc knocks on my door, I expect it's going to be for something, if not extraordinary, at least interesting. This is an open case of suicide. And, Benny, we're at the point where we need to know what we're doing here. Blanc notices the old baseball lying on the grass. He picks it up idly. Method. Throat slit. Typical suicide. Dramatic. Look around. The guy practically lives in a clue board. Artist sits alone, across from the portrait of Harlan. Muffled voices on the patio. Cigar smoke drifts by outside. She creeps over to the glass door, puts her ear to it. You asked me to drag all these good people back for questioning, go over it all again. I don't get it. It's a pleasant family with usual quarrels but no possible motives for a murder. Where are you going? At that moment, Blanc's face appears right next to Marta's, staring right at her through the distorted glass. She hopes it falls back. Blanc opens the glass door. Marta steps back sheepishly. With a warm nod, Blanc beckons for her to join them. Roland Thromby's nurse, Marta. Cabrera. Marta Cabrera. Miss Cabrera, you can just wait inside. We'll be with you soon. Miss Cabrera, I've been doing a lot of poking. What fucking accent am I doing? Sorry. Miss Cabrera, I've been doing a lot of poking. You're hired on a part-time basis as a registered nurse, yes? Yeah, I don't work for the VNA. Harlan hired me directly. Paid a flat rate for how many hours a week? Started at 15, but slowly he needed more help. Medical help? Needed as a friend. Mark smiles at the girl, genuinely touched. Does having a kind heart make you a good nurse? Blanc. Yes. Marta, we're just discussing possible motives in the family. I suspect Harlan has told you much of the unfiltered truth about each of them. A little bird has told me. How should I put this delicately? You have a regurgitative reaction to mistruthing. Who told you that? Is it true? Yes. It's something that I have had as a kid. A physically thing that I just the thought of lying, it just makes me puke.
Really?
Is Richard having an affair? Stunned. A flashback she reads as Harlan sits at his laptop, heavy with sadness. Why do men instinctively pull at loose threads on their parachutes? What? Harlan spins his laptop towards her and the Richard photos. Back to our scene. Marta looks queasy, tries to stall.
Richard? Fair?
A yes or no would do. She struggles, her jaw clenched, face working hard at attempts.
No.
It immediately vomits into a nearby planter. Oh my god. They all rush toward her. Blanc brings water, awfully concerned.
Dear girl, I'm sorry, I assume you were speaking figuratively.
Keep going in and out of that accent, I'm sorry. It's gonna happen. Blanc takes the shortest acceptable beat of concern before turning to Elliot.
Write something.
I was obviously right. Richard is having an affair. His father-in-law found out and confronted him. You tell her or I will.
Maybe that's true.
You okay? Marta gives a weak thumbs up, recovering. Even if that was right, protecting his marriage is weak sauce as a motive.
Well, and then there's Joni.
Lifestyle guru, Joni.
No, Harlan was supporting her and her daughter. She had the opposite of a motive. Marta tries to quietly slip back into the house. If that support was threatened, Miss Cabrera, one moment, please. Just going to get some scope. Miss Cabrera, was Harlan planning on cutting off Joni's allowance? Off Marta's old God no face? Flashback. The letters. Transaction receipts. He sighs heavily. Oh, Joni, what's up? He hands her the letter. Marta's face works against impending nausea. Okay, don't answer that if you're going to puke, please. But Blanc presses. Meg said Harlan pays the school directly. Joni says he sends the money to her. Both were true. She was pocketing the double payment. Harlan found out and cut her off without a cent, yes? Marta starts to shake her head no, but her throat convulses. She nods. Blanc hands her a glass of water. He bumps him off for the inheritance. Come on. Have you seen her Insta? She's an influencer. Fucking hate them. And the allowance as a motive, Blanc. She has her business. More weak sauce. Blanc idly scratches the spot on the side of his neck. Granted, but she lied. To me, to all three of them did. Three? Walter. I see where you're going with this. There was something else. Harlan had turned Walter down before regarding film rights. That night, what that Harlan said shook him. Look at the pattern. Harlan was cleaning house. I wonder. Did you plan to fire Walter? Can I wait inside? I don't feel like I should be here. Yes, please, just wait inside. Yes, please, just wait inside, but stay close. Steps back in, grateful. Blanc to Elliot. Very patient, my friend. You're right. None of these weak alibis and domestic squabbles answer your question. Why is Benoit Blanc here? Now I will tell you why. I'm here because this morning someone dodged one very important question. Who? Me. Linda asked who hired me. Who hired you? I do not know. An envelope of cash showed up in my apartment yesterday with the news clipping of Thrombey Steph. An envelope that worked? An envelope of cash. Blanc indicates with his fingers, several inches thick. So somebody suspects foul play, but goes through this hotshot dance of hiring me. Staying anonymous. Makes no damn sense. Tells me though. Why would we do everyone's whereabouts at the time of death? Elliot hesitates, but Blanc got him hooked. Flips open his notebook. Blanc leans back, closes his eyes. You know, the party broke up at 11:30. Marta and Harlan vanish up the stairs towards the third floor, while Richard and Linda head into the bedroom right next to the stairs. Down the hallway, Joni waves and ducks to another bedroom. Marta took Harlan upstairs to give him his meds. Marta, Linda, Joni went right to bed. Now we do have this. The stairs leading up to Harlan's bedroom and his attic office creak horribly. Sleeps deep. Linda sleeps lightly. Well, Linda's the light sleeper. So we know every time someone took the stairs that night. First was when Jody heard a ka-thunk from somewhere above her in the house. She's concerned about Harlan. She went up to investigate, waking Linda. Jody knocks on the door of Harlan's attic office. It opens. Harlan answers. In the room behind him, we see Marta, her back turned, preparing a hypo needle. Harlan was in his attic office with Marta. He explained that they had just knocked over the Go Board. The game with the grid and stones. Played it every night. She was fine. Go to bed. So she does. 10 minutes later, Linda is woken up a second time by Marta leaving. Walt, I'm leaving! Walt was smoking a cigar on the porch with his son. He saw her leave, drive off. Noted the time, midnight. Linda with a pillow over her head. 15 minutes later, Linda is woken up for the third and final time by someone coming down the stairs. Walt still smoking with Jacob, spots Harlan through the glazed glass. Coming down the stairs in the foyer, Harlan came down for a midnight snacks, which Walt tried to discourage. Dad, go to bed. Through the glazed glass, Harlan goes back up the stairs. Based on this, the medical examiner determined the time to death to be between 12:15 and 2 a.m. As Walt was finishing his cigar around 12:30, Meg came home. He went straight to bed. Walt and Jacob turned in shortly after that. Meg pulls up and trots past Walt and Jacob inside. Sometime later that night, undetermined by possibly 3 a.m., Meg woke up because the dogs were barking outside. She used the bathroom and went back to bed. That's it. Everyone's stories match. Every movement accounted for. No other staircase to Harlan's room? No, just a creaky one. Interesting. Guess we could rule out Ransom. He wasn't there. And Marta, Harlan was alive after she left. But Meg got home during the time of the death window. Except it was a suicide. Harlan hit both carotids. We saw from blood splat patterns that they were uninterrupted, meaning it's almost impossible for anyone to have been around him at the time. The one that cut his own throat. I don't know why we keep going over this. Physical evidence could tell a clear story with a forked tongue. What? As we've seen this morning, everyone could lie. Well, almost everyone. Harlan sits, setting up a go board. Marta enters. It's late. I had champagne. Oh no. It's my birthday. We are... Yeah, one glass. Not breaking tradition on my birthday. Marta puts two vials and a pill box on the go board. She pulls out two plastic wrapped hypodermics. Take your goddamn medicine and go to bed. If you're gonna put that vile shit in me, you will have to earn it. On my birthday. 85th. So old. So old. Alright, old man. 8x8 game. You ready? She sits. They start clacking white and black stones on a board. Can I beat you at this game? Because I'm not playing to beat you. I'm playing build a beautiful pattern. Oh, uh-huh. They play fast. Marta's obviously winning.
Elder abuse. I'm calling AARP.
Don't make me get the belt. It's basically over. I only hope earthquake will strike. But what are the chances? Harlan starts shaking the table with his knee. Looks around, startled. Marta just stares at him, deadpan.
Get under a door frame!
He tips the whole table and go board and med vials, syringe, and med kit. Fall to the soft rug. Soft. Things spill out. The med kit, a mess. Marta just shakes her head. Meds fit beds. Fair. She retrieves the vials and loads the syringe from one of them. Harlan rolls up his sleeves, revealing a pre-inserted catheter. Crosses. Closes the room's only small window. Ugh, Walt's smoking on a cigar on the porch. Nasty things. Almost tonight. She hooks the syringe to his catheter and slowly injects him, bit by bit while he talks. That was good. I know you weren't looking forward to it. No. But I did it. Put the line on all four of them. It's not easy. It's goddamn fortune. Sometimes I think everything I've given my family I've done, maybe without knowing it. Maybe to keep them beneath me. Should have. What? Maybe. I don't know. Encourage Walt to write his own stories, not just be a caretaker of mine. Like you said,
I should have, like you said, I should.
And a father. Not just a provider to Joni. Like you've also said. Should have been kinder to Linda. And Ransom. Curved ornamental dagger from display mount. Turns it over in his hand. Jesus, there's so much in me and that kid. Confident, stupid, I don't know. Protected, playing life like a game without consequences. So you can't tell the difference between a stage prop and a real knife. Very important. Stabs into the desk, sharp and real. Leaves it there. I don't fear death. God. I'd like to fix some of this before I go. Close the book with a flourish. Guess we'll see. Guess we will. Hey, old man, you had a long day. What did you do, drugs? Close the second syringe from the second vial. Made good stuff. Yeah, just a tiny bit. Sim made a La La Land. City of stars. Are you shining just for me? God damn it, I wish La La Land played. Damn it, it didn't play. That would have been great timing. Oh well. Why did I wait until my mid-80s to become a morphine user? What a schmuck. What a nut. Hey. Yeah. I won't say that part. I could, but I won't. This stuff's the best. Pulls the needle from the second vial. Then sees the label. Freezes. Blinks at it. Oh my god. She snatches the first vial. She just injected from. Compares the label to the one she just picked up. Similar, but not the same. Is there a problem? This is what I just gave you. 100 milligrams of... But I messed up. You gave me 100 milligrams of the good stuff? She merely pulls an emergency kit from nearby shelf. Starts calmly, but quickly going through its contents. What's the good stuff's dosage supposed to be? I call it that right now. 3 milligrams. That's much less. So what happens? I give you an emergency shot of naloxone. That you don't die in 10 minutes. Well, no pressure. Oh, that's interesting. Efficient method for murder. I need to write that down. It's a little notebook and scribbles while she checks and rechecks the kit contents for increasing urgency. If someone switched the meds on purpose, I'd be dead in 10 minutes. Like, stone cold dead? You'll feel symptoms in 5. Sweats, disorientation, then yeah. That big a dose injected within 10, your respiratory, your... Yes, 10 minutes. Time of injection, so 8-ish now. And even if the victim called an ambulance when he first felt symptoms, he was at a country home like this where the ambulance takes 15 minutes to arrive, it'll be too late. Victim didn't have this emergency Knoxville stuff. He watches her. She's now digging around the carpet. Looking under the couch, she dumps the entire contents of the kit out, now frantically going through it. A bead of sweat rolls down Harlan's brow. Marta? Do you have the Naxal stuff? Yes! The Naxalon. Yes, it comes with the emergency kit. It should be here. It's... Fuck! No, Harlan. It's not here. It's not? Oh my god. They look at each other for a second. She's panicked. He's thinking. It's my phone. Shit. Picks up the landline phone on the table. Dials 911 with shaking hands. Before it can even ring, the line goes dead. She looks. Unbelieving. Harlan's finger is on the cradle. His eyes are locked with hers, serious and certain. Harlan, what are you doing? Marta, listen to me. Harlan, we need to... Stop, 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 Marta. Crazy. Are you crazy? We need to call. I need to get you. Get here. I need to.
Listen, there isn't going to be time to stop. Now stop. Goes for the cell phone across the room and Harleen stops her. They trip and fall into the ground with a thunk.
Bardo, what are you doing here?
Wait, God, I'm... Oof. What are you doing? Are you nuts?
What are you doing? Are you nuts?
Marta, it's too late. It's over.
It's too late. I am dead. Listen. Listen.
He actually puts his hand over her mouth.
Listen.
What you said is true. I am gone. There's no saving me. We have 6 minutes. One last thing I need you to do in this world. I need to do in this world. Only you can help me do it. I need you to trust me. Do everything I say. What do you want me to do?
Get you out of this.
Think of your mom. Please trust me. I have to make this look ironclad, like it couldn't have been your fault. You can't have done this. My mom?
Get up.
Creak on the stairs. Knock on the door. Harleen! Marta? Is everything alright? Harleen and Marta stand. She's dazed. Deer in the headlights. Focused and sharp, she turns her away from the door.
And here, keep your back to me. Don't say a word.
Harleen opens the door. While he gets rid of Joni, we stick with Marta. Stands stock still. Tears running down her face. Eyes wild. What does she do?
Hi. I heard something.
Everything okay?
Oh, yes. Just knocked over the go board. Sorry about that.
Everything's alright?
Yes, all fine. Go to bed, Joni.
Okay. Maybe we can talk tomorrow about the, thing with,
Yes, tomorrow.
Love you. Night.
Night.
Harleen shuts the door. Looks at the knife still sticking at the desk. Takes Marta's shoulders. Looks her in the eye. Pay attention now. Mom's still undocumented. This is your fault? She'll be found out and at best deported. Your family will be broken. You kind of fear in Marta's eyes. Oh, God. But we're not going to let that happen. I have a plan. It's not going to be easy, but you have to do exactly what I tell you. Will you do this, Marta? This last thing for me. For your family.
Terrified, she nods. What do you want me to do?
Go downstairs as noisily as you can. Say goodbye loudly.
Walt, I'm leaving.
Quickly down to her car. Call attention to the time. You can. God, it's midnight already. Drive out the gate and then, to avoid security cameras, pull off the rope before the carved elephant. Ahead, weathered wood carved elephant statue. Wait. Before or after?
After the carved elephant.
No, we said before.
But after four.
The carved elephant.
Shit.
She yanks the wheel and pulls off before the statue. Marta trudges away from the parked car, three branches catching her hair. Park, come back on foot up to the house. Take the side yard path through the little gate. Dogs sprint down a moonlit yard from the house towards Marta. Dogs will know you. They shouldn't bark. The dogs stop at Marta, licks her hand. Marta looks up at the side of the looming house, sturdy. Trellis on a wall, high above a third-story window.
Got to get up to the third floor without being seen.
The only way is to climb the side trellis. Coming through the trick hall window.
Gotta be kidding me.
I am not. Do it.
For goodness sake, don't make any noise.
And a piece breaks under her foot. Comes back later. Everything in this film... It's with a purpose. There's reasons for it. It comes back later. It's very detailed. And that's the beauty of this film. Of the writing in this. Everything is with a purpose. And this is why I'm reading it. It's a great one. What appears to be a dead-end hallway with a painting at the end. But suddenly the end wall swings away like a door. Revealing a window behind it. Marta heaves her way through it. Lightly steps into Harlan's bedroom. Once you're inside, this is the tricky part. This is the tricky part? Get my robe and cap from my bedroom and put them on. Picks them up from the bed. Stops.
moment of doubt. Back to the scene with Harlan. Marta stops him. Harlan, this is crazy. We need to make this so airtight, your average cop will entirely dismiss you as a suspect. This seems crazy, but it will work. Marta in the robe, pulling a cap on, tucking her hair under it. Marta and Harlan's robe and cap creeps down the creaky stairs and keeps going. Walt and Jacob are smoking outside. They'll see you. Through the glazed window. Dad, go to bed. We're seen leaving. The security cameras show you driving off. 20 minutes later, I am seen alive and well by my son. Gone from suspect number one to impossibility. Leave the way you came and don't be seen. She hops to the ground, then freezes. Almost shouts. She's facing the darkened first floor window. Wide open. And inside it's staring right at her. It's Great Nana. Marta's frozen. Great Nana isn't moving either. She has her eyes locked on Marta. For what seems like forever. Great Nana cocks her head to the side slightly and asks,
Ransom, are you back again already?
Marta breathes and backs away. It turns and goes quickly. Down across the lawn. Drive home. Sometime in the next few days, the police will call you. Harlan, I can't lie. I'll puke. Don't lie. Tell fragments of the truth. In this exact order. Okay. That was basically the setup scene. And it's amazing. An amazing setup scene. Detailing how the death has went. Two different perspectives, what the cops found out, and the actual perspective of Marta. So, actually quite intriguing and an incredibly written out segment. It's absolutely beautiful. Okay, so let's catch you up. Marta is now working with Benoit Blanc, and they're trying to figure out everything. He trusts her because she has a kind heart. And cannot lie. So, now. They went to check the security tapes. Marta actually did fuck up, and you can see it. And then she takes the tape before they could actually see it. Now she's trying to cover up everything, and we are going back to the house. The group hikes up the woods. Towards the low wall, small pedestrian gate that leads to the east lawn. Marta is out in front during During the following, she notices something. The earth around and under the gate is soft, bare, clear as day. Her footprints from the other night. Only ones from women's shoes. Same ones she has on now. Breath catches. Shit. Any luck with, what's his name? Ransom. No, but we have an address. Take Canuck Street. In Canuck. That's a thing to say. Canuck. Woku amid Canuck. Oh, this mud. My boots are going to stink.
Mud.
Has it rained the past week?
No! Nobody move!
Freeze. Everyone, these footsteps must not be disturbed. Marta! Marta's already walked through the pedestrian gate and up into the lawn, stepping in her pre-existing prints. Turns back, playing dumb.
What?
Don't stop there. Don't. I can't hear you. What? She trots back through them, through the gate, stepping into her returning footprints.
No, don't. No. Don't step in them. Okay, all right.
Okay. What? Blanc sidesteps up to the gate. Not stepping in the mud. All right, Wagner, let's get these boys in and on it. Check the prints. Tape off the air. Keep it clear. Dogs come running through the lawn, barking at the mud, at the men. Tear through the gate, further messing up the mud.
Hey, boys, easy. Hey.
He pets them, and they quiet down. Best judge of character is a dog. Found that to be true.
Dogs start barking and bolting toward the house, where Richard and Linda are pulling up in their Lux SUV. Doing the will reading here at 10. The whole family will be here soon. Elliot heads up towards the house. Blanc meanders, but the lawn and Marta follows. Never been to a will reading. Think it would be like a game show. No, imagine a community theater. Performance of a tax return. They approach the side of the house. Blanc does a gentle, meandering study of the layout. Marta steals a look. The trellis she climbed. Oh no, a piece of the white lattice trellis broke off. She was climbing. About 8 inches long. Eyes in the grass beneath it. Her eyes dart up. Yep, there's the broken spot.
Shit. Sweet beans!
Marta starts. Did he spot it? No, he's come face to face with Great Nana. Standing shocked still on the porch. He stares at him like a bird.
Good morning, Miss Strombi.
He approaches her slowly. With his back is fully turned, Marta takes her shot, kicks the piece, trails under some thick bushes at the base of the house. Blanc and Great Nana stare at each other. Blanc gets very close to her, great sympathy in her eyes. Great Nana stares back. Almost like they're communicating. It goes on a little too long. Blanc breaks from the trance and turns to Marta. Think you can handle the study?
As a matter of fact, eat shit. How's that? In fact, eat shit. Eat shit. Eat shit. Definitely eat shit. Eat shit. Oh my god. The funniest part is Michael Shannon in the background. I'm not here one iota of shit. I don't know why that is so funny to me. I love it so much.
Oh, man. When Shaolin Blanc is heard enough, he sets the baseball down on the side table, drifts out. Marta follows him. Okay, so we skipped ahead. A lot of things happened. The will reading was read. Harlan's leaving everything to Marta because everybody's a selfish little asshole. And they all turn on Marta. So Ransom picks her up and takes her away from there. Marta confesses to him because he figures it out. The reason why he figures it out. And then, yeah. We're going on this goose chase. What's going on? Why is everybody so distant? And we had to go here. Somebody told Marta that you have to go here to see if you want answers to the truth going on. Now, 120... stupid. Now, 1209 Columbus Road. Dark, empty retail space lit only by the painted over front windows. Marta edges her way in, her eyes still adjusting from the sun. Hello? Her foot hits something on dirty concrete floor. Her medical bag. Niels picks it up gently. Where it was lying, she finds something else. Curious, the burned remnants of a piece of paper. Only a charred corner remains. Oh, wait, hold on. Sorry, there is something I need to say. Something that's happened here. So, Benoit Blanc finds out, and then he says, Marta, come back to the house. We need to talk. Ransom and Marta take off in a high-speed chase. They catch up, and they get Ransom. They take him and question him. So, Benoit Blanc is with Marta, and then they're driving around. Marta says she has to drop off something. She has to do something real quick, and it's this. So that's where we are. Sorry, I forgot about that part. I thought that was after. Yeah. She turns her attention back to the room. Creeps forward. Hello? Ahead, a silhouette. A person seated in a chair. Center of the room. Silent. Facing her. Listen. I don't know what you want. Whatever you want, we can work it out. We have to figure it out right here, right now. I'm leaving with that report. Oh yes, the toxicology report, how he actually died.
He doesn't want to get found out from that. A beat of silence. Nothing. Something's not right here. Hello? Marta takes a step closer. Lifts her phone. Turns on its flashlight. Illuminating the ghostly face of Fran, the housekeeper. Marta barely breathing. Fran? Spider crawls across Fran's face. Ugh. Marta stifles back. A scream and leaps. Sucking in air. Moment of stillness. Her phone buzzes. Blanc calling. Marta ignores the call. Frozen. Her eyes go to a white letter-sized envelope and Fran's hand resting on her lap. Marta swallows. Leans in carefully and quietly. For some reason. Slips the envelope from the lifeless fingers. Unsealed, she opens it. It's empty. Or, Skeeve is sinking a rattling, grating, draw of breath from Fran. Marta starts, oh my god. Goes to her, checking on her pulse. Checking her eyes. Lays on her back. Fran sucks in a thin breath. Her eyes finding Marta in a glare. Dropped phone flashlight. Blah. I was gonna say phone light. I think I did. Whatever. Fran, can you hear me? Fran, give me a sign if you can hear me.
You.
Me? Fran, it's Marta. You called me here. You sent the email. I'm here. I'm going to call an ambulance. You're going to be okay, but can you tell me what happened? Did you take something? What happened to you? Weak, Fran grabs Marta's wrist. Marta focuses on her.
Got beat.
What?
Stash.
Where it's barely given any breath.
You did this. Won't get away with this.
Her eyes seize. Her breath gets ragged. Marta is paralyzed with shock and fear. Fran is dying. Marta looks at the medical bag in her hand. And at Fran, struggling with her final breaths. Eyes wide with fear. She takes a step back from the dying Fran. Fingers tight around the medical bag, letting her die. Then, a decision. No. Marta dials 911 on the speaker. Drops to her knees and starts administrating mouth to mouth. Time for us to get into the nitty gritty, the ending, the big reveal. What's going on? Does everybody know? So, let's get this going. Rolling. I keep rolling. Here we go. The family gathered, impatient. Lieutenant Elliot, Troop Wagner, are there too. With another uniformed officer. Ransom sits in the corner, his face passive. Marta gulps. Blanc is a few steps behind her. She speaks, he unfolds and reads the tox report. You guys have always been good to me. What I'm about to say isn't going to be easy. I'm going to be upset. Especially after everything you've gone through the past few days. I thought you deserved to hear it from me. Walt smiles at her, doing the right thing. Marta takes a deep breath. Blanc has finished reading the report. He refolds it carefully. Excuse me! You have not been good to her. Vol treated her like shit to steal back a fortune. It was lost and she deserves. You're a pack of bloody vultures. At the feast, you're not getting bailed out, not this time. Pretty sure he says knives out at this point. He says knives out. It is not here, so okay. Miss Cabrera has decided definitively not to renounce the inheritance. What? Furthermore, it will be my professional recommendation to local authorities that the manner of the death in this case of Harlan Thrombey is ruled as suicide. The case is closed. What? But no, Blanc. Thank you all for coming. Goodbye. He firmly guides Marta by the elbow. A beat of silence. Is anyone else confused? Oh, this is where she finds it. Okay. As the family breaks out in the hubbub, Linda notices her dad's old baseball on the side table where Blanc left it. What's that doing here? Picks it up. Blanc steers Marta into the library. Sounds of hubbub and shouting come from the other room. What the hell? I want to come clean. This is over. Almost.
Elliot bursts in, motions to the living room, then Marta, then Blanc. What? I'm sorry, Officer Wagner. Wagner insists, please keep the family out of this room. Get them out of the house if you can. But stand by with your additional officer. Family out? Yes, but not all of them. Blanc whispers something to Wagner. Who nods and exits. Blanc, come on. What's all this drama? Indulge me. Or sits. Elliot remains standing. Blanc? I told Ransom. Ransom told you. I'm telling you now. The immovable fact that I killed Harlan. Yes, you did. Yes, he did. Yes, you are. But. I spoke in the car about the hole at the center of this donut. Yes. What you and Harlan did that fateful night seems at first glance to fill that hole perfectly. Donut hole in the donut hole. Must look a little closer. When we do, see that the donut hole has a hole in the center. It's not a donut hole at all. But a smaller donut with its own hole. Our donut is not hole at all. Blanc, I understand that this is amusing for you. Why was I hired? Why would someone hire me? Someone fishing around any crime that could help reverse the will. I was hired before the sealed will was read. Yes, the person must have known the contents of the will. But one step further. Same person must have known a crime was committed. Further. The intent was to reverse Marta's inheritance. Must have known that Marta was responsible. An intriguing combination of factors. Someone who knew what Marta did wanted to expose it. Could not reveal how they knew. Fran? She was blackmailing me. She knew what I did. But Fran wanted money. Ergo, did not want the crime exposed. Someone in the family see Marta doing something suspicious? They would have no reason to not speak up, no. Answer, it's not so simple. Blanc sits, suddenly weary. Now with the entire solution, my field of view, the arc of this case, tragedy of errors. Marta, not be easy to hear. There's at least one truly guilty party behind it all. Guilty in the sense of acting with malice. Commit a heinous crime with selfish intent. Trooper Wagner. Wagner? Blanc squints at her. No. A moment later, Wagner leads Ransom in. Ransom looks at Marta softly and sadly. Marta, I'm sorry. I told him everything. I figured it was all up. I'm sorry. All right, Ransom. I'm glad you did. Not exactly everything. What the hell? Not exactly everything, though. Is this about what Crit Nana told you? She saw me that night. She mistook me for Ransom. We'll get to that. But first, Mr. Hugh Ransom Drysdale. You might tell us all why you hired me. Why I hired you? Right, let's back up. To the night of the party. Your argument with Harlan. You overheard by the words of the Nazi child masturbating in the bathroom. My will, I'm warning you. You and Harlan were drama mamas. You shared a love of twisting knife to one another. I don't believe he would have slipped it in halfway. No, I submit that Harlan told you everything. Can't be serious. Not a red dime or word of my work. Not a single one of them. You included. Marta, remind me what Ransom said this conversation with Harlan ended with. Harlan told him that I could beat him and go. I asked myself, Marta? Why would the topic of the will be steered around toward Marta? There's one obvious explanation. You're not this crazy. Would not just throw away your fortune. No, I'm giving it to Marta. All of it. The Brazilian nurse, you're goddamn insane. Saying for the first time in my life, I've done it. I've made
the change to my will. It's done. I'm going to stop this, Harlan. I'm warning you. Push into the vent in the wall. That's some heavy-duty conjecture. Granted. It's the only way what comes next makes sense. You storm out. You drive off into the night. Tell Marta later of what was it. Feeling an overwhelming sense of clarity. That he has to make do for himself from here on out.
Exactly.
Ransom's Porsche skids to a stop, side of the empty road, sits idling. Marta, the will, Harlan, you won't get away with this, do for yourself, and a plan forms. A beat, the Porsche roars into a skidding U-turn, drives back it the way it came. Ransom's Porsche kills its lights and drives slowly to the private road, hooking the left in a carved elephant that marks the utility road. See, if Marta went after, she would have seen him. You return, careful to avoid the gate security footage. Porsche parked, Ransom hacks his way through the woods, on foot up towards the house. You sneak in, up the trellis, so as to not be seen by the rest of the family who are still having their party downstairs. Painted wall swings aside. Ransom climbs through, leaving mud traces on a sill and the carpet. Heads down the narrow hall and into Harlan's bedroom, the party den from downstairs. You need to do will take moments. It's essential you are alone, undetected. Ransom disappears in the darkened hallway. Doorway. You knew the medications Harlan took. You knew what Marta would be injecting him with that night. And you knew if Marta was responsible for his death, even unintentionally, the Slayer rule would nullify the change will, and you would get your share back. Dark and still. Marta's medical bag open. Ransom has unwrapped two syringes, two vials out. Toradol and the morphine, the good stuff. Uses syringes, he extracts the liquid from both vials, then injects liquids back into the opposite vials, which is the medications. Use the syringes and the kit to switch the liquids into two medication vials. The final precaution, you take the myloxine, the life-saving antidote. Replacing the vials, he takes the injection pen, loses the bag and leaves. Marta's stunned, she can't even process. Oh, that's impossible. It is the truth. Hand me that vial of morphine, I'll show you. Marcus placed two identical vials on a table behind Marta. Her mind is still spinning. She glances at them, takes one and absently hands it to him. He did that. Meds were switched up when I got them mixed up. I accidentally switched them back. Then I gave Harlan the correct doses. Yes, but not accidentally. I taped over the labels of these two vials. Shows white tape over the one she just handed. Picks up the other vial, shows the same. Vials themselves are identical. How'd you know that was the morphine? I just knew. You knew because the slightest, almost imperceptible difference of tenor and viscosity, shit, big words, between the liquids. You knew because you have done it 100 times. You gave the correct medication because you are a good nurse. And Harlan was. I'm sorry, Marta. Yes. Harlan was perfectly fine. And folds the tox report and hands it to her. His blood was normal. The cause of death was truly, solely suicide. You were guilty of nothing but some damage to trellis and a few amateur theatrics. In fact, if he had listened to you, he would be alive today. Right as white as a ghost. She shudders, buckles over. God damn! Twisted web. But not finished untangling it yet. Marta, when Great Nana spotted you climbing down the trellis, she said, Handsome, are you back again already? Or are you back again
already. Because earlier that night, Ransom, you're back. Exact same scene, but Ransom hops down off the trellis. Starbuck Grit and Nana staring at him. Puts his fingers to his lip. Shh. Blows a kiss as he walks off into the night. Marta with her fingers on her temples, still unbelieving. Marta, come on. This is stupid with two O's. You don't have a shred of evidence just spinning a fairy tale. No, not a shred, no. Just as we have no real proof of Marta mixing up the vials, so it's your word against you have our confession. The sharpness of this makes Marta look at Ransom for the first time. Oh, right. We do have that. If you indulge me, I'd like to spin a little further. Moonlit silent. Much later that night, you would have to come back to the house to break in and retrieve the incriminating tampered vials. Dark figure Ransom approaches the side gate. When he opens it, the two dogs come bounding across the lawn, barking loudly. However, this time the dogs were outside. They barked, waking Meg. Light goes on upstairs, the dogs keep barking, paws on the gate. No matter, you'll get the vials tomorrow. But tomorrow brings news of not of a medical error, guilty nurse, but of a slit throat and a suicide. Nurse Fitz Ransom. There's a clipping from the newspaper about Harlan's death, stuffs it in an envelope with a huge photo cache, addresses it to Blanc. New Yorker. Profile open on the couch. Now the circumstances are perfect for the anonymous hiring of me. You know a crime has been committed by Marta. You need to her to be caught for it. You cannot reveal how you know. Enter Benoit Blanc. Well, he can't help but lose his eyes. Any look, I hear what you're saying. But I quickly shush Elliot, enthralled by every word Blanc says. As am I. The body was discovered early the next morning. The police and medical examiners, the family, everyone swarms in. Then there's no possible way you could get to Murdo's medical bag to remove the vials. You must wait for your moment. When the investigation is over, you know the house will be empty. That is why you miss the funeral. There's no one home to wonder why you're going to Harlem study. So you think. Fran comes around the corner, spots Ransom. He's about to say something, but doesn't. Poor Fran. She witnesses you tampering with Harlem's medication and medical bag. You gotta know what you were doing. She knew you were up to no good. So your mind begins to turn. Ransom pockets two incriminated vials from the medical bag and replaces the myeloxapine. When he stands to go, she retreats. God, that movie she told me about. Danica McCullough, what she talked about? Deadly by surprise. She loved Harlan. She hates Ransom. But the poor girl decides to test her theory, make this asshole pay. She gets a copy of the toxicology report. I'll be honest, I have no idea how. She has a cousin. She told me. Cousin who works in the receptionist at the examiner's office. Well, voila. The numbers mean nothing to her. But if Ransom is guilty, existence is a threat. So she photocopies the header and makes her a blackmail note. Why did she send it to me? She did not. She sent it to Ransom. When Ransom first gets it, what is his reaction? Elation! He still thinks Marta gave Harlan the tampered drugs. Blood tox report proved Marta's guilt. Will reading. The family is simple. Ransom sits in back, a sly smile on his face as the will is read. Goes to the will, reading in high spirits, ready to see the family tear themselves apart, secure in the knowledge that it will all be undone when the tox report comes to light. And then, Marta's confession. And everything's turned on its head. Now he realizes that Marta has committed no crime and the tox report will prove her innocence. Change will is going to stand. He is lost. Unless you decide. You're not going to give up the money. You're not going to give up the money. Come this far. You've come this far. Just one step further. Just one last act. In for a penny, in for a pound. You decide. You're in. A lighter ignites a rag stuffed in a tin gas can. Thrown through a window at a brick wall. Empty, dark, the flame and can falls in slow motion from the high window. Step 1. Destroy all evidence of Marta's innocence. Step 2. Send Marta an anonymous email with the late morning rendezvous time. Late. Deliver her the blackmail note. Step 3. Keep your appointment with Fran.
I knew it. I knew you were no good son of a bitch. I knew Harlan went and just killed himself.
Yes, you were right, Fran.
You were guilty as shit. Now you're gonna pay for it. Don't come near me. I'm warning you. He's upon her. Hand over mouth. Stifling her. Scream as he pushes the syringe into her neck. Pushes the plunger. Minutes later, her inert body in the chair. He fishes through her pockets. Finds the envelope. Takes the tox report from it. Leaves the empty envelope in her hands. On his way out, lights the tox report on fire, drops it burning next to Marta's bag. We stay with it as it burns away. Board is set. Marta will get the blackmail note. You will put the pieces together for her. Tox report, one chance at getting away with it all. You'll guide her to the rendezvous. You'll make an anonymous call to the police. They will catch her there with the body and the burned evidence. Marta will be arrested for killing Fran and Harlan. She said, "You did this.
You did this."
She didn't say you did this. She wasn't talking about me. She said,
"You did this.
You did this. Because you made the help call you Hugh, because you're an asshole. Would have worked. We hadn't brought you in for the questioning, so you cannot make your anonymous call. And if Fran had not stashed a safety copy of the tox report." Marta turns away from dying Fran. "And if Marta had not outplayed you once again, by having a kind heart, by saving Fran's life, though it meant her losing her inheritance and going to jail, she didn't play your game. She saved Fran's life." For the first time, Ransom looks afraid. "Fran's alive?" Marta's phone starts to ring. We all see caller ID is the hospital. "Oh yes. Fran, who will confirm this fairy story, something close to it, will send you, Hugh, to jail." He answers the call. Puts the phone to her ear. "Yes?" Long beat, then her face breaks in relief. "Yes, thank you, doctor. It's great news. I'll be there soon." He hangs up. Smiles with radiant joy. "She's okay. She's ready to talk." Ransom stares at Marta, his face a mask. Trooper Wagner, you will keep Miss Drysdale in custody while Lieutenant Elliot, Miss Cabrera, and myself go to the hospital, take Fran's statement." Ransom stands, steps to Marta, who's frozen, looking in his eyes. His poker face breaks. He grins. "I want to say this just to you. Not to a courtroom of cameras. Just to you, because you know it's the truth. We allowed you into our home. We allowed you to take care of our granddad. Be a part of our family. And now you think you can steal it from us? You think I'm not going to fight for our birthright, our home, our ancestral family home? Harlan bought this house in the 80s from a Pakistani estate baron.
Oh, shut up, Blanc. Shut up. Shut up with that Kentucky Fried Foghorn Raghorn draw. Yeah, I killed Fran. But I guess I didn't. So what do you have on me? Nothing. What, attempted murder? I get arrested for the bombing. Maybe a few other charges. But good lawyer, I'll be out before you know it. Face to face, Ransom's face hateful. Murder strong and set. And then you'll see just how much hell I could wreck on your life, you vicious little bitch. But then, Murder's face starts to do things. I think convulses, her jaw clenches, her cheeks bulge, and projectile vomits onto Ransom's face. Ah, what the shit? He falls back, cursing. She drops her knees, spitting. Wagner, inappropriately excited. That means she was lying. That's right. France dead. You just confessed to her murder. Ransom takes this in. Then he smirks. Well. And for a penny, one fluid motion, he spins to the ornamental wall of knives. Grabs one. No! And tackles murder. Time slows as Blanc and Elliot lunge to stop him. But it's too late. Ransom and Marta fall together, his arm arcing down. As they hit the ground, his arm comes down, plunging a knife into the hilt, into her chest. They lie still, breathing hard. Her eyes wide with pain. The horror is cold, wild. Then she blinks, squints, cocks his head, realizing something. Draws the knife from her chest. It's fake bleed that retracted into the handle. It's a theatrical prop. He pumps it up and down a few times, a spring making a pathetic toy noise. Ransom smirks. Shit. It's violently tackled out of the frame by Trooper Wagner, leaving Marta lying on her back. Blanc shouting as if she's alright. Elliot Wagner wrestling Ransom into cuffs, all fades into the background. She holds the knife, stares at the ceiling. On his old baseball set, being set carefully back into place by Linda, she's about to leave. She notices the pink envelope on the desk. She picks it up, takes it out to a blank note. She seems to recognize it, smiles sadly. When it comes outside, it joins the family. Several more police cars and an ambulance. Ransom is loaded into the cop car. His family are held at bay by police officers. They react in different ways. Richard yelling at the cops, Walt sobbing. Donna collapsed against him. Jacob on his phone. Joni staring at the space ruined. Meg talking to Lieutenant Elliot crying. She's just learned about Fran. Linda watches the circus. Strangely disconnected, going to light a cigarette. Strange smirk, she uses the flame, formed a light blank note from the office, and hidden writing starts to appear. A note from her father, their secret communication. As the letter appears, her face changes. Marta sits, a blanket over her shoulder. An officer who's just taken her statement walks away. Blanc approaches. Can I ask? At what point did you suspect I had something to do with Harlan's death? From the moment you first set foot in front of me. Perhaps a shoe, a tiny, faded spot of blood. Oh my god. I want you to remember something very important. You won not by playing the game Harlan's way, but yours. Through the window, through the walls, till the sweat drops down. She sees the family outside. I should help them, right? I have my own opinion. I had a feeling you'll follow your heart. He gives her a wink. Strolls off. Now shuffles to the front doorway. One last glance at Harlan's portrait. His grin, now gentle and content. Oh yeah, the portrait keeps changing. He stands at the threshold. Sees Blanc on the front door of the cruiser. Drives off. Ransom in the back. Looks back at her through the window.
Family on the lawn, not sure where to go, what to do. They all turn to see Marta standing, very small, but somehow not in the doorway of her house. Oh, that's it.
That is the end. Well,
thank you for watching. Thank you for hanging out. This has been Knives Out. We finally did it. We finished it. Yeah. It was supposed to be done months ago. Thanksgiving. Because it came out around Thanksgiving. So Thanksgiving. Got it. Blah, 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 blah. It's one of the longer episodes of recent Rescribed. But I think it's a very good one. Thank you for watching. Thank you for hanging out. Remember to check out all my other Rescribes. I just did Mean Girls. That was a fun one. We did Black Swan, Hocus Pocus, a bunch of other stuff. So, check them out. It's been a good one, fun one. I'm not sure what I'm doing next, but I have an idea. Let's take a gander at my notes. Oh, God. Oh, no. The film I plan to read next. I don't know if I'm gonna do it, but if I do, you'll realize what this reaction is. Okay. For now, I'm out. I'll see you guys when I see you. Follow me on social media. Follow me. Letterboxd, Instagram, Spotify. Keep up with reScribd. Subscribe here on YouTube. Make sure you keep up with the Righteous Room podcast. We'll be doing a lot more. Hell, we'll probably be back for the Oscars. That'll be a very fun time. It was fun last year. We'll do it again this year. For now, I'm out. I'll see you guys when I see you. Peace. Wanna be a legend? Right, wrong, remember what I said then? Cause now we rockin', now we rollin', now we rockin', now we rollin'. We keep going for all time. Keep playing my rhymes for all time. We keep going for all time. Keep playing my rhymes for all time. I wanna be a legend. Right, wrong, remember what I said then? Cause now we rockin', now we rollin'.